Hello and welcome to Future Squared. Stephen Hawking once said that intelligence is the ability to adapt to change, so let's adapt. My name is Steve Glaveski, and each week I'll bring you conversations with preeminent thought leaders from a variety of fields to help you think in a multidisciplinary way, keep goals in your professional and personal life, and better navigate what is fast becoming a brave new world. And without further ado,
come with me if you want to live.
Welcome back to Future Squared for episode number 410 with Adam Jones and Adam Ashton. Yes, I've got these two Australian larrikins, if I can even use that term, back on the show. And you might remember them from episode number 190, way back when, about 3 years ago, that I last spoke to these two gents on the topic of how to learn. And of course, Adam Jones and Adam Ashton are the co-hosts of the immensely popular What You Will Learn podcast. If you're not already listening to it, it should be on heavy rotation in your podcatcher. It's a great place to learn the best bits from the best books. And speaking of books, the gents have taken the learnings that they have extracted from over 100 books, in fact, 115 books, and distilled it into a 600 plus page behemoth of a book of their own called The Shit They Never Taught You. And it's full of insights, full of wisdom on some of the big questions that perhaps we don't really learn about, or perhaps we don't learn the answers to at school. So these are questions like how to learn, how to love, how to think, how to make better decisions, and on and on and on. And of course, if you're a fan of Future Squared, you'll know that these are questions that we explore on this podcast. And so this was an opportunity to not only deep dive into some of these topics, but more so into the craft, if you can even call it that, of reading books and putting what we learn from books into practice, but also our relationship with books. Do we need to read books at the right time? Does our relationship with a book change, either for the best, or perhaps we look back on a book and perhaps say, hey, I can't believe I even liked that book. What the hell was I thinking? Whatever the case, for book readers, for knowledge seekers, for curious cats, this is a conversation for you. And a quick note that you should listen all the way to the end, because there is a very special musical treat for us, care of the one and only Adam Ashton. It's a number on the piano, and it is well worth listening through to the end for. So with that, I'm going to wrap up this introduction and bring you the one and only, or is it the two and only? I don't know how to phrase that. But nonetheless, here are Adam Ashton and Adam Jones of the What You'll Learn podcast.
Ashto and Jonesy, welcome back to Future Squared.
Hey, thanks for having us back. I'm sorry that we're not as tall as Andrew Bogut, but we're maybe in aggregate, maybe.
But yeah, in aggregate and together, you have a personality that's even bigger than Big Bag. Big Bag. Shouldn't have had that second beer. Big Bad Bogsies.
Mate, it was a great app.
It was all right. It was all right. I mean, I probably got a lot of hate from certain people who tend to fall victim to the... It's not the halo effect. I think it's the horn effect where because someone says something you don't agree with, suddenly absolutely everything else they do or say is also bad. And therefore, anybody who associates with this person is bad as well. So you see this playing out now, and I'm kind of digressing from the point of today's conversation, but you see this playing out with both Andrew Bogut. So he's obviously had some political views that are a little bit right of center with respect to lockdowns and stuff. And then when he was hosting or co-commentating the Olympic Games, the Boomers Games with Andrew Gaze, he got a lot of heat on Twitter saying, oh, I can't stand listening to Andrew Bogut. But I don't think any of that had anything to do with his commentating ability. No. It was purely, well, he's got these political views, therefore I think he's a shit commentator.
One of the greatest basketball exports, surely, the country's ever had. Definitely.
Well, surely. I mean, who else is there? Luke Longley?
Yeah. Didn't get much airtime in the documentary.
No, he got no airtime. I mean, I think you could see him walking into the dressing room at one point after one of the games. was about
we've actually had we haven't been doing too well recently with that. We've got Ben Simmons, who's probably the most hated guy in the NBA.
Most hated and most immature guy in the NBA, I think we can all agree. Didn't he declare that he wasn't going to represent Australia at the Olympics because he wanted to work on his game? And then during the Olympics he was spotted like at Wimbledon with some new lass he had could be jacked up with.
Could be the sour grapes there though, Steve. Yeah. Like, he's the one with hundreds of millions of dollars, could get any girl in the world that he wants. So if we
said he was working on his game, he didn't necessarily say his basketball game.
This is true. that's a great point.
Maybe that's the game. He
was working on his game.
Fantastic. Well, boys, it's an absolute pleasure to have you back on the show. I think the last time we spoke would have been a good 3 years ago or so. And since then, you've gone from strength to strength. You'd be well into what 400 plus 450 plus episodes by now on what you will learn.
Yeah, maybe. It might be given a bit of salt and pepper, but yeah.
Yeah, a bit of salt and pepper, a little bit of embellishing. Look, I don't mind a little bit of embellishment.
More than 300, definitely more than 300, probably more than 350.
Yeah. More than 350, fantastic.
Big growth, I think, Steve-O, that I remember last time we declined the whiskey because we quit alcohol at the time.
You did, but that never really, like, how's that going for you, mate? I think every time we have a podcast, I got to bring up the alcohol. But, you know, you've obviously graduated, if I can use that term, from not only podcasting but to becoming fully fledged authors with the release of your book, The Shit They Never Taught You. And I'm not going to say the stuff they never taught you like some mainstream media outlets chose to or name names there, but it's a behemoth of a book, 170,000 words, over 600 pages. You've packed 115 or wisdom from 115 books into it. What was the initial sort of seed? What was the initial inspiration for this book? At what point were you guys, we should take this and turn it into a book?
That's a good question. I remember it was at a cafe at Higher Ground, probably just two or three Higher blocks ground, from here.
Yeah.
Probably,
I think we've had coffee there once. Yeah.
2.5 years ago, we were like, we're thinking of writing a book. We don't know what. And then eventually we got to the point where we actually did it. Yeah.
Well, I think it was a bit close.
It was a while ago. I gave you guys a lot of crap about how long it was taking you, and you even acknowledged that in the acknowledgements. So
that's right.
Yeah, you did. Yeah. Well, I kind of remember inspiration actually here, like the Elizabeth Gilbert Big Magic style. If you've read that book, it's a bit of a woo-woo sort of book. But like when an idea does hit you, you do get those tingles and this hit of inspiration and loads of energy to be able to go and tackle something. So I feel like we did that, and we initially had a prototype of our top 50 books of all time, which was a downloadable product on the internet, which was doing all right, nothing crazy, but doing all right. So as an MVP, we thought, all right, let's iterate on that, call it the top 100 books of all time. And we, in our mind, it was like a clear finish line before the project started. So that's what we launched into doing. And then, as we can get into if you want, but we had a few feedback iterations from that where we ended up with a product totally different, which took a lot longer to make, but it was entirely different to what we originally conceived of by the end of it.
It's interesting what you say there as well. Like when you first have that seed of an idea, you're full of energy and enthusiasm. And I personally find for myself, my experience has been that I need to keep that in check because it's so easy to fall victim to, say, the optimism bias. And that initial optimism can be very blinding. Like all you see is green lights. You don't see any of the potential red lights and traffic jams and everything else on the way. So what were some of those traffic jams and red lights?
Without doubt, that's the best thing possible, I reckon, is the false image of green lights.
Yeah.
Because if you're like, it's going to take you guys like 18 months, 6 different drafts starting from scratch, going back and forth countless times. We probably just said, no, we're not interested.
You'd say no to the podcast. You'd say no to everything.
Say it was a podcast. If you're like, no, it's going to take you 20 hours a week of doing this podcast, and you'd probably say, no, let's not do it. But when we're like, let's just fucking go and hit record, and then we'll hit stop, and then we'll upload. It's all good. Let's just do it. And then it kind of built up from there. Same as the book. We're like, we've done the top 50. Let's just do the top 100. We'll just flesh it out a bit more, and then it'll be done. Publish a book, and that's it. So that was like almost the necessary step of thinking it's just going to be green light, green light, green light. Let's just go, go, go. And then, down the track, a few red lights popped up, but we were kind of pot committed by that point, so we just had to keep going.
I think it
was Jordan Peterson's the second book. He does talk about the benefit of the fool. Like, we see the fool as a bad thing, but, historically it's seen as a net positive thing because the fool sort of just like stumbles forward naively with it, you know, eyes in the air. And if you're too rational about it at the start and too, get your head around it too much and try and plan everything out, then, it'd probably be a net negative thing.
Yeah, for sure, man. And I think despite the fact that the optimism bias can have its sharp edges and kind of lead you down the garden path, once you're already on that path, like you've got a bit of momentum. Like you said, you've already done 50 books. Well, we're not going to quit now.
Yeah.
Like, and then obviously the sunk cost fallacy comes into it as well. So there are all these biases that can work for you and against you.
That's right.
And by that point, it's like, well, let's just keep on going. But I imagine you, something you've covered on your podcast is the dip. Seth Godin's a dip. I know, Ashton, you're a big fan of Seth Godin. What was the dip? Or were there many dips with this? And how did you get past that?
Oh, definitely. Well, I think the first... So we got to the end of what we thought was the first draft. And that was when Jonesy infamously said, I think we're about 90, 95% done.
Yeah.
Which was about 2 months into the 18-month journey. so the percentages were a bit off. But it was very much... So then we had our 100. We had 100 books... From 100 down to one of what we thought were our 100 favorite books, about 1,000 words on each. So we'd sort of spent a good 6 weeks hardcore writing from scratch to fill 100,000 words. And that's when we sent it out to a few people, yourself included, and got some feedback. And it was kind of like, yeah, look, this is okay. It's not bad. It's a bit dry. It's kind of lacking a bit of life. It's a bit random how, like, what's the order of these books? It's like, to us, it made sense because we were like, well, this is our order of 100 to 1. But to somebody who hasn't read these books, it kind of, there was like a philosophy book, then a business book, then a like a general personal development book, then a career book, then a psychology book. And it kind of had no flow to it.
Yep.
So anyway, that was like the first feedback. We were kind of like, okay, well, what do we do now? We can either ignore the feedback and just push ahead and think we're right and we'll just do it our way. Or we thought, nah, okay, let's... A lot of people are saying the same thing. We should probably listen to that and go back to the drawing board.
And that that writing process you speak to where you said, you know, for six odd weeks, you were like full steam ahead writing. When I wrote Employed Entrepreneur, I went over to Thailand. I had the privilege to go over there for a couple of weeks. And every morning I'd write for 2 hours, have some breakfast, maybe go for a Muay Thai session or something, then write for another 2 hours.
I thought you were going to say something else that started with M in Thailand. That's what I've
something else starting with M.
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, that's your mind, mate. That's not me. Anyway, I lost my train of thought now. You got me thinking about other things. Anyway,
maybe I had a very different Thailand trip to yours.
But by taking that approach, I found after a couple of weeks, I actually had about 50,000 words done. So in your case, like, what was that process of trying to just get into flow on a daily basis and crank out as many words as you possibly could?
Well, I think did something similar personally. I went to Indo for the first iteration. Yep. Ashley did it from home. So, but I'd probably talk about one of the final iterations where this is where we both had our day jobs, right? So we've still got a day job that we're doing. We just made sure that our system one, our highest value work time, was actually at the start of the day. And because we're in lockdown, we could actually, you know, design our days like that. Our 7-8, I think we called it hell month, which was end up being a hell 2 months.
Inspired by the Navy SEALs.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that was an 8-week period where our first 2 hours of the day we'd touch base, it'd be our final iteration. We'd just go very hard on it, writing period. So, and then our system two was left to our employees at the time. So that was all right.
Bad luck.
No, I think that's absolutely key. And, you know, it comes back to your own circadian rhythm in terms of when you prefer to work. So for some people like myself, I'm an early bird, and I'm the same. So I'll have that system one work done in the morning between say 8:30 and 11 or so. That's when I do my best work. But something like 40% of people are night owls and they do their best work 10 hours after waking up. So just for those night owls out there listening, you don't need to do your system one work first thing in the morning. You can leave it for later in the day. Just make sure you don't get on the beers too early like me. Otherwise, you'll be tripping over some of your words. So this book, as you indicated earlier, you know, self-development, psychology, philosophy, entrepreneurship, marketing, all sorts of good stuff. Talk to me about the magic pill. What is the magic pill and how does it relate to your book?
All right, I'll shoot with this one. So for us personally, we were very different before we started reading.
Yep.
So the magic pill we pull from...
You mean you used to drink before and you still drink now, so...
Well, before we started reading, I was like a pack-a-day smoker. Yep. I was doing university, but things were slowly going down the toilet. If I stayed on that path without books,
yep,
I'd be in a totally different place than I am now. So the magic pill is from the movie Limitless, where, you know, Matthew McConaughey, I forget the actual...
Bradley Cooper,
same thing. But he takes the pill. Yeah, he's the
character. Same thing. I actually always get those two guys confused. So
he sees everything clear, and it's probably as a metaphor or an analogy, it's like essentially the silver bullet.
Yeah.
So we don't believe that there's silver bullets that are out there, but if there was something that's the closest to a silver bullet, we think it's books, or mm-hmm, actually more specifically the equation of reading books and learning from books and doing shit.
Yeah.
So add those two things together. We think that's the best formula out there for the silver bullet, so, or the magic pill.
Mm.
So that's what we start the book with, because for both of us, it has been the closest thing for that. Because, yeah, books, you open yourself to the widest range of mentors you could possibly imagine.
Yeah.
So your mate, Sir Isaac Newton, you know, if I was standing on the shoulders of giants.
Yes.
That's where he gets his genius from. And someone's packaged their whole entire life's learnings into one bloody volume. So it's the most undervalued commodity on the planet, yeah, we think. And this is why it's the magic pill. And if people aren't reading right now, then they should go out there and start reading.
Yeah, definitely. And I love the title of the book, you know, The Shit They Never Taught You. Because one thing I've written about in the past and spoken about is the fact that when we're at school, we don't learn some of these fundamental things like how to think, how to make decisions, how to love, how to work, how to learn, how to manage your emotions. All these really core things to being a functional, effective human being. We don't learn any of that. We learn how to,
derive what is polynomial.
Pi? And then, 3.152. I think that was it. But
we learn this stuff. 1.159. But
there you go. You learn this stuff, but then you get out into the real world and you realize that shit, I'm not as smart as I thought I was. And Ashto, I know that's kind of a theme that comes out of this book in terms of your life, where you kind of killed it in school, crazy off the charts IQ, and then you got into the real world and you had some sort of rude awakenings. Tell me about that.
Well, yeah, I think that's like, for me, like school kind of became a little bit of a game, just because there's a textbook, there's like a curriculum, they're like, here's all the things you got to learn at the end of the year, we're going to test you on it. So it's kind of like the rules of the game are very, very clear. Mm-hmm. If you do this, you work harder than everybody else, you learn a little bit more than everybody else, you remember a little bit better than everybody else, you get to the test and you probably do a little bit better than everybody else. But then obviously, as soon as you hit the real world, there's no textbook, there's no curriculum, there's no rules, there's a few tests, but they're very different to the tests you do in school.
Yep.
And so all of a sudden, it's a completely different game. So I think you probably got to work out your own game and sort of forge your own path, create your own rules as you go through that game. So for me, it was no longer about the textbooks, trying to get up early to study hard and memorize a whole bunch of stuff that I've now forgotten.
Yep.
It was probably just thinking about, okay, well, what's this game of life? How can I play this game?
Yeah, and something you touch on in the book is playing a finite game when you should have been playing an infinite game. Mm-hmm. And of course, we're kind of echoing Simon Sinek's Infinite Game here, where you had a big night on New Year's Eve and you were going to hand in a resignation. Tell us about that.
I was working at Crown Casino. I was dealing poker, and I suppose to go back a step. So like, I'd obviously worked hard at school, finished year 12, sort of had in mind what I wanted to do, and I thought, okay, everybody wants to be like a lawyer or a doctor. They, mm-hmm, for whatever reason, are like the top two professions at the school I was at. And then I was like, okay, well, I like sport, so I'll do like a mixture of medicine and sport, which is physio. So I started doing physiotherapy. Very quickly realized that there's almost no sport in physiotherapy. It's a very different field to what I thought. I thought I'd just be hanging out with all the AFL players or the NBA stars and just, I don't know, massaging their hamstrings or something, and then partying with all the girls.
You're
going to
say massaging something else?
Man. You and your Thailand trips, actually.
But then I started it and it just was not for me. So I had a semester off. Was dealing poker at Crown.
Mm-hmm.
And then I thought, I wanted to I think the reason for quitting was actually I was trying to start up my like first business, and I needed like two specific days off, and they're like, no, we can't give it to you. So I was like, okay, well, I'm going to quit. And I thought I'd do the real tough thing. I'd just walk in, hand in my resignation letter, slap it down on the pit boss's desk and say I'm out. But then as I was walking up, it was New Year's Eve and it was pretty full, and I was wearing a singlet and thongs, and they said, mate, you're not coming in here dressed like that. So I had to just had my resignation letter, took it out of my pocket, gave it to my girlfriend at the time and said, so, can you take this in and put it on the boss's desk? And the boss just would have taken one look and shaken his head, and I don't think I got a shift again after that. They were probably happy to see the backside of me.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you make smart decisions when you're drunk. You know, that's all part of life. But I wanted to double click and go down the rabbit hole of books and being a book reader. So I've been, like yourselves, reading more or less a book a week now for maybe 10 years or so. And if I reflect, probably longer, 15 years or so, and if I reflect on those early days of reading books, I remember myself being quite righteous. Okay, if I read about something in a book, it had to be true. And then if somebody had a contrary opinion, I was like, no, mate, you don't know what you're talking about. Like, for example, the Lean Startup, I thought every startup idea needs to be tested and validated early. But that's not true for all ideas. Like, for example, if you're testing an idea in a small market and there's maybe two or three big buyers in your town, you don't want to pitch them with a half-baked product because that might burn your bridges and then you're done. And potentially, like, if you're pursuing something that has high costs or high barriers to entry, where the first iteration of it has to have some kind of utility, Lean Startup might not work for you. But having said that, coming back to that righteousness piece, especially in the current climate where we have people in the political landscape, both on the left and on the right, who are very righteous about their views and see everyone else as just wrong. And I might channel Socrates here, because he did say, you know, the more you know, the more you realize you know nothing. So how has reading hundreds and hundreds of books changed your relationship to the books themselves, and how pessimistic you may or may not be towards what they say?
Wow, there's so much in that. I like it. Yeah, I've been on the same journey. I think Lean Startup at the start, we're like, yeah, this is the Bible.
Yep.
But then, you know, you got the dichotomy of get it done mode, and you just get shit done. But then sometimes you put in a shit product out the world, which is an MVP still, but it's not actually something that's quite right.
Yeah, I think people forget the V, the Bible.
Yeah, and MVP. Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And then the other end of that is like Perennial Seller, where like Ryan Holiday, which is our favorite Ryan Holiday book, he talks about like anyone who's created a perennial piece of art in the world that sells upon selling and actually generates word of mouth is because it felt like eating glass, or was that painful to put it out in the world. That's what it takes, and that sort of feeling to put out something that's quality. So I think that, like, I'd say book number 200, which was The Art of Strategy, which talks a lot about context dependency. It never really clicked until this idea popped into my mind. Like, every book out there, it's got its purpose in a certain specific context.
Yep.
And over time, you can understand what that context is. You pull out the Lean Startup MVP, or you pull out Perennial Seller and you need to go hard and build some quality. Or another dichotomy might be How to Win Friends and Influence People, where you're just being a friendly person who's quite agreeable. But then you got the Robert Greene dark side mentality, where you're, you know, putting your assertiveness into the world. Mm-hmm. So out of all the different books you got, they can always be put into a dichotomy in that sense. Some people say about books, like if you read 1,000, the sum of all books and the diversity of them equals zero. So what's the point of reading 1,000 books? But I really disagree with that. I think you can read very wide, and with that diversity, add it to the context dependency, and then you'll be in a very, you know, strong point. And when life throws curveballs at you, which it's always going to do, you're going to be prepared with ideas from some thinker who's had that situation in the past.
Yeah, and it might even feed your subconscious thinking without you even realizing it. Like, all these different ideas, it kind of, you absorb them. You might think, that book was whatever, but then you might encounter some experience in your life and subconsciously you're like, actually kind of know or have a feeling as to what I should be doing here. And the point you make there as well around like asymmetry, for example, one of my favorite books of all time, Richard Feynman's Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman, he talks about asymmetry in circumstance. So, and you see this all the time in the sort of, you know, entrepreneurial advisor, mentor, keynote speaker space, where someone will say, well, this is what you should do. Here's the battle plan. But what worked for them for the time that they were building that business, the type of business it was, et cetera, those same circumstances may not be the circumstances that you as an entrepreneur are facing as well. So while there may be some truth to their argument, it may only work, or it may only work as well given the unique circumstances that that advisor or mentor or whatever faced. I mean, that's something that I think we oftentimes forget. And the business bookshelves are littered with that sort of advice, which is based on the narrative fallacy. And hey, it worked for me. And here's the steps that worked for me. Forgetting everything else in that picture and saying, if you do this, you will be successful.
Yeah, 100%. Like Art of Strategy, that book, it does talk about, like, in terms of game theory, there's two ways. You've got the wood chopper who goes out with the axe and chops the tree down. The tree doesn't respond to the chopping of wood. So if that was the game of life, then you know, and that strategy would work every time for that tree, but the general response to what the army's doing. So it's understanding you've got a moving target, the changes all the time. And yeah, what worked for some person could have been an entirely different army that they were dealing with compared to what everyone else is dealing with.
Yeah, yeah. And I think Napoleon was famous for his strategy in war, which was very much about adaptability and decentralized command. Whereas oftentimes when he'd be fighting the Russians, they were waiting for central instruction from Moscow. And because the conditions on the battleground were changing so quickly, Napoleon's men oftentimes emerged triumphant because they were able to rely on decentralized command, and those commanders on the ground could say, okay, things are changing, we need to change our plan. They were empowered to make decisions, and therefore they could make decisions faster and get to a better outcome. Whereas the Russians, like, oh, this isn't what we expected.
This is what the boss said.
You know? Yeah. And I'll channel Customato for the 727th time on a podcast. Everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. Right. And it's so true.
I love it.
Anything to add on that, Ashton?
I think just the main one is probably the meta level of the magic pill. So I think when I started reading, every book felt like the magic pill.
Yes.
Every book was like, wow, I can't believe I never knew this. How, and you know, the shit they never taught you. Why the fuck didn't someone teach me this in school?
Mm-hmm.
For me, it was like I started reading The Rules of the Game by Neil Strauss, which I thought I was reading The Game by Neil Strauss.
Yes, tell us this story, because you read this book and you kind of mastered it from what I could tell and you applied its learnings and then you're like, all right, I'm done.
Yeah, that's right. So what
happened here, man?
Everyone was like, when I was like in maybe year 11, year 12 at high school, The Game was going through this massive sort of cult following.
Yeah, I remember
all the teenage and early 20s boys are reading The Game, learning about the underground pickup artists who had all
negging
these,
and
negging, yes. DHVs, all these techniques and tactics to manipulate girls into dating.
How do you think that book would go today?
Has it been cancelled? If it hasn't, I'm sure it will be.
Yeah. Anyway,
so I was like, okay, I better read The Game. And then so I think I was with my dad, went to the bookstore and went to buy The Game by Neil Strauss.
Mm-hmm.
Dad accidentally bought the wrong one. He bought The Rules of the Game by Neil Strauss, which was, I guess, a follow-up, a spin-off, probably a money grab. He probably sold a lot of copies and thought, the publisher said, have you got another one in you?
Yeah.
And so it was like a 30-day personal improvement plan, which is probably actually a good book as well.
Yeah. That made the cut today, that one.
Say that again?
That would make the cut today.
That would make the cut, yeah. And it was just like, it was more like, okay, day one is like, I don't even remember what the days were, but you know, look yourself in the mirror and give yourself a pump up. And then day two is like, go and get a haircut so you actually look presentable. Day four was like, go to the shops and buy clothes without that your mum hasn't picked out for the first time ever. And then like day six was like, learn this one technique of how to talk to somebody. And then like day eight was like, okay, now it's time to put this into practice and go and talk to a girl. So day eight, I ended up talking to a girl. I used some of the techniques from day six, a bit of a palm reading technique, managed to escalate the Kino, you know, some of these, the tactics from the game, and ended up making out with that chick that night. And that chick then became a girlfriend, which then became a long-term girlfriend, which then became a fiance. And then in a couple of weeks or a couple of months, it's going to be a wife.
Yes.
And then, that was it. That was the magic pill.
Yeah.
Just had to read like eight pages of The Rules of the Game. And then that's it. Relationship's done. Don't have to talk to girls ever again.
Mate. And that's like a big, like fundamental, you know, change in your life. And you were what, 20?
I was 18. Like 18. Literally, I was like 17, I just turned 18.
This is where we're different, actually. Like if I had read The Rules of the Game and I had sampled what it taught me, and I the first time I tried it, it worked. I'd be like, I'm using this on everyone.
You're like, explore mode.
You're like, I'm taking my winnings, I'm out.
That's right. I found the magic pill, and then so then I like read Dale Carnegie, How to Win Friends and Influence People, and I was working in a job. I was pretty bad. I was like a summer intern.
Yeah.
And there was like 40 people competing for 10 spots, and I was probably ranked number 39 or number 40 on that list. But it turns out like that the last test to work out which of these 40 people are going to get the job was just like a presentation, a 10-minute presentation on what have you learned from the last 8 weeks that you've been working at this place that you've never worked before. And I managed to, you know, have a bit of fun, actually confidently present, weave a bit of a narrative, tell a story, pull out some lessons with a few examples, and I seemed like a gun. And they were like, man, this is the future of the bank. And so I managed to get that job. So I was like two from two, girlfriend, job. And then I read Gary Vaynerchuk, Crush It, started a business. So I was like, man, every book, there's a magic pill there.
Yeah.
But then kind of, I guess I got a little bit more jaded. Like the more books you read, like they start, as we said, they start to contradict each other. Some books are just shit. Like
yeah.
Some books are long and boring and there's not really much point to it. But it's got, I think the magic pill is less about one specific book and more about becoming a reader. If you can become a reader, add that habit of reading books, learning new things, trying new things, adapting new habits, I think that's the magic pill.
Yeah. And I think that's a good point to make, because you might read, say, David Epstein's Range and then, you know, come across Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hour rule and they kind of are in conflict with each other. But through that, you start to appreciate that a lot of things do exist on kind of a spectrum. Mm. And it's about, oftentimes, as the Buddha told us, finding the middle path and finding that balance and not overcommitting to one end or the other of the spectrum. In that case, it's not 10,000 hours. Maybe it's going deep on one discipline, but also having a wide range of other sort of secondary disciplines. And now you see that play out in the tech world with T-shaped individuals, where it's like, yep, I'm deep on software development, but I'm also across organizational culture, a little bit of marketing, a little bit of philosophy, and all these things that are important if you're building a new organization from the ground up.
100%. Yeah, the combination that's just like, I think comes back to Seth Godin's The Dip, really. It's like the dip creates scarcity and the scarcity creates value. So it's like, how do you build the scarcest skill set that you possibly can?
Mm.
And there's like, there is those few paths to get there. You can go range, where you add a skill stack that's very rare in the marketplace and no one else has that skill set. So that means by that, you've got disproportionate value. And you've done 10,000 hours, but you've done it with like five lots of 2,000 hours in different things.
Yep.
Or you go hardcore into the 10,000 hours, super, super duper niche, which might be a bit more competitive, but at the same time, you got that scarcity, which is creating that value in the marketplace.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And I think I've seen that play out with you guys in terms of your respective sort of disciplines in marketing and engineering, but also having such wide interests and not like reserving yourself or not restricting yourself to the tiny little pigeonhole.
Yeah, absolutely. I think doing a bit of rogue shit in your career has always been good and helpful for me. I started in like your stick up the ass sort of corporate firm, and if I just kept the stick up the ass, you'd probably be in a very worse position if you just go rogue and not too rogue, or maybe pretty rogue.
Rogue's good.
Like, I love rogue bogues.
Rogue bogues. Yeah, he's coming back.
Well, our man Robert Greene, he does talk about like cultivating your uniques.
You guys love Robert Greene.
We do. He's our favorite author. So there you go. He talks about the cultivating the unique seed. Like if you think about Steve Jobs, when he rocked up to the office, he'd be wearing no shoes, stinky as anything sort of thing. And that's like how, in a sense, like the world reality sort of calibrated with his uniqueness and sort of pushed him in a direction where it actually worked for him.
Yeah. He also got fired at some point.
Yeah, he got fired. But he also got pushed in a certain sort of way. So I think that, taking the stick out of the ass helps.
Yeah, definitely. And we'll move on from that analogy.
There's a quote for you.
Well, take the stick out of the ass. That's going straight into the Instagram tile promoting this episode. And speaking of Instagram and Twitter, you know, when I see your posts pop up, oftentimes there'll be a rating for a book. And sometimes you guys will be on par, but other times you might be like complete different ends of the scale. Like Ashto might give something a 9 and Jonesy will give it a 4. It might be the other way around. I mean, what's one book you guys like vehemently sort of disagree about? Yeah, what is that book?
I think there's a lot. There's a lot to choose from.
What's the one that comes to mind?
The first one that jumps to mind, a recent one was Enlightenment Now,
mm-hmm.
which I remember, I think Jones probably gave it a 9 and I gave it 3 or something.
Yep.
And I remember you commented as well saying, what the fuck, Ashton? How could you give it so low? I don't know. I just wasn't like that captivated.
What was it about the book that you...
I just found like the style was a bit dry, a bit too academic, a bit long, a bit boring. It didn't really just grab me. And it didn't seem like it had that one spark of like new insight that I was really amazed by.
Yeah. Is that just because you're kind of across the idea that we have it fundamentally better now than we did, say, 100 years ago in terms of, you know, a number of different metrics and therefore...
Yeah, I think probably because I'd like heard him speak about it a lot before. I'd probably heard other people reference his work because he is so big and he is so popular. Everybody else talks about it as well. So it probably wasn't... It didn't like feel new and insightful to me. And it was probably just because I had already kind of heard it before.
Yeah. Okay, so that's why you gave it such a low score. Why did you give it such a high score, Jonesy?
I thought it was in the where we are right now,
yeah.
Culturally, one of the most important messages out there because mm-hmm. it's so easy to just take everything we've got for granted at the moment because we're in the best time in history. We're living better than French kings of the 13th century, even if you're on the low class spectrum. So even if you're middle class in this culture, then I think that context, it just kind of slaps the idea out of you that your life's hard, really.
Yeah.
It adds to that. So I think, in two different ways. It kind of makes you more grateful if you start whinging about things. And the other thing, it's just good to point out when you're trying to argue with people who think differently,
mm-hmm.
it's so factual and there's got so much meat in it that you can actually just reference that and say, go and read that bloody book and then let's talk about how bad things are today and how much of a disaster we're in.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And I think if you spend all of your time on Twitter, you probably think the world's the worst state it's ever been. But if you take a step back and zoom out, and oftentimes when I do bring up this book and some of the statistics around, you know, if you lived 150 years ago, you probably wouldn't have had access to electricity, sanitation, clean running water. You probably would have worked 12 hours a day for like $2 a day in a coal mine. You should be grateful for how good you have it. And then critics of Steven Pinker will say, yes, but there are certain classes that are actually worse off. Like he's looking at it at a macro level as opposed to a micro level. So there are certain sort of socioeconomic classes in the United States who have it worse off than their parents and are making less than their parents were, essentially. And then there is the risk that things are good now, but like per the Black Swan, there could be an event where while things are good now, the evolution of, say, nuclear warheads and technology is at a point where if someone does want to push a button now, they can do a lot more damage than they could have, say, 150 years ago when the worst that could have happened was people running out with their muskets and stuff. Whereas now someone can push a button and we're all fucked. So.
I thought, like, in that one, the equality was, like, the hardest one beforehand. Like, surely, whatever he says in that, I'll buy everything, but sure, we're not as equal now because of... You got Musk's and Bezos with that much money, and then you got the. But he does talk about equality in terms of like, we've probably got the same TV as Elon Musk has. He's probably got the same air conditioning. So, and then the developing world, it's like they get completely missed out of all these equations. Like the developing world actually do have air conditioning now, electricity, all these sorts of things, mm-hmm. and the same electricity that Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos use. So, in that sense, comparing someone starving to doing pretty well a century ago, like the whole world has been much more equal.
I think so. And I think the perhaps one of the downsides of it all is, and you know, you guys had Daniel Kahneman on the podcast recently. That was a fantastic episode. People should definitely go off and listen to the boys interview the master.
That's it.
But he did publish a paper with Amos Tversky, I believe it was, on how people, once they get to $75,000 a year, emotional well-being and life satisfaction rises with income. But after that point, the connection between income and life satisfaction kind of, it's decoupled. Making more money doesn't necessarily make you happier when you reflect on doesn't necessarily make you happier. What does is, you know, meaningful work, meaningful relationships. And perhaps that's part of the downside. Like, we have built this materialistic capitalist culture where we do have all of these, you know, perks, electricity, et cetera, et cetera. But at the same time, perhaps it's come at the cost of our emotional well-being, because if you look at some of the statistics around depression, anxiety, something like 1 in 3 people suffer from depression. So perhaps when people criticize Pinko, and I'm not for or against that, probably in between you guys, I see merits to both. Perhaps some of it comes down to the fact that we're looking at it from certain metrics, which paint it in a positive light, but then metrics around emotional well-being, which you perhaps saw with the lockdowns recently, you know, it was all case numbers, but not so much people at home tearing their hair out. So I guess there's, and that points to what we were saying earlier, like balance, like it's a spectrum. It's not right, wrong. It's like, all right, there are different variables you kind of need to think about.
Yeah. I think that's always the challenge, is if there's so many different metrics that you can evaluate things on. And if everyone's just looking at one metric, then they're blind to all the other metrics. And I think that goes for everything. Obviously, the lockdown's an obvious one, but it's everything. It's career. Like, probably the easiest metric to point to is how much money you're making.
Yeah.
But that doesn't take into account how hard you're working. Are you enjoying it? How much free time have you got? Where are you working? Like, there's so many different metrics that people are blind to there.
Yeah. And metrics that can kind of lead you to fall into like traps.
Mm.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, yeah, what, optimizing for the wrong goals.
It's like Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. One that does criticize the Pinker style and a lot of Heights and Peterson and all those crew. It's like the Phaedrus knife. It's like when you actually get the rationality and apply it to things.
Mm-hmm.
When you tap it, you sort of lose something in the process every time. So even if you apply just pure rationality to say how things have gotten better, it actually misses like a big part of the equation that's very hard to explain. That's probably why you didn't like the book.
I don't know. I still don't know what Phaedrus's knife is.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't either. So I had an open
loop. I read that book. I was actually learned more about that book from listening to the podcast episode you guys did about it. I was like, a lot of that shit flew way over my head. And then I listened to your episode. I'm like, man, that kind of makes sense. I get it now. So it took me like 15 hours to read the book. And then I listened to your episode in 30 minutes. And it was like way better use of my time. So people should definitely check that episode out. But just on that point as well, like, you know, you read the Stoics and it's all about rationality. And then you read some new age spiritual stuff where it's about trust your intuition. But I don't think it's one or the other. And I think some of the studies that have been done on people that had part of their prefrontal lobe that's responsible for emotion weren't able to make decisions. Mm-hmm. Like, they could not choose between having the cheeseburger or the Big Mac, because you need some emotion to kind of guide that decision making. Rationality without any emotion kind of renders you disabled in a way.
Yeah, and culturally as well, because that's what the book talks about. It's, you know, not directly and explicitly, but if you had rationality purely, why the hell would you kick a football around in between goals? Or why would you go and see artwork? Like, rationally, none of that makes any sense. So if you just purely apply the rational filter to everything, then there's like so much we get lost culturally. And it's hard for us to explain why there's value in going and watching the footy or anything like that.
Mm.
You know, I probably got trapped in my early 20s like that. Like, I've stopped supporting St Kilda, the footy, and because what's the point? They're just blokes hugging each other on the footy field and kicking balls around.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't think it's pointless anymore.
Yeah, yeah. And I think we often forget that. It's like, I went through similar things as well when, like, in my 20s, it was all about, I guess, during a period of my 20s, like, working out and, you know, maintaining a healthy lifestyle. And therefore, I wouldn't go out on a, you know, Friday night and get blitzed and stay out until 4 in the morning because I had to go to the gym at, like, 8 a.m. or whatever. But you kind of... And again, this comes back to metrics. It's like, yeah, you're optimizing to stay healthy, but how healthy are you really when you're not out there socializing with people, meeting people, potentially meeting someone that you get engaged with and get married with 2 months from this podcast recording? And that's the thing, like being multidimensional and looking at all the different metrics. And that's something that I think people who perhaps haven't gone down this personal development rabbit hole would get from your book, because it's not just psychology, it's not just entrepreneurship, it's not just philosophy. It's like a good spread of ideas and great ideas in this book from, you know, 115 odd books. So how do you, you know, for someone who perhaps is a noob to the personal development space, I mean, how do you think their relationship with this book will be?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting one. And as you said, 115 books, we kind of group them into 32 meta lessons in 9 different parts.
Yep.
And we kind of reckon there's a few different ways you can read it. One is the obvious cover to cover approach, but with 680 odd pages, that might take you a little while.
Yep.
One is just a kind of the coffee table book approach, where you know, pick it up and flick through and open to any section and learn something new. Or one is like the pick 10 approach, where you might like get a little bit of a taste of a section. It might be the title that grabs you. It might be the specific area that it's in that grabs you, and
mm-hmm.
and explore it. And then you might learn something new, and then pick another one and test it out. And I think going wide is probably a good way to sample, especially early in the reading journey. For me, every book was amazing. So I think if it's early in the reading journey for you as well, then I think every new idea will be like a bit of a slap in the face, a bit of a, why the hell didn't someone teach me this sooner?
Yeah. It's like anything new you do, like there's a book where sometimes we get on an idea and we just talk about the same idea all the time. This is a new podcast, that's right. But Algorithms to Live By, where it's a computer software analogy, which you might be aware of. Yep. It's like the explore versus
I actually learned it from your book.
Yes,
that's where I first was introduced to it.
There you go. 100%.
Yeah,
well, if you're going somewhere
rule. Like was it Brian?
Yeah.
Brian.
Who was the author of that book?
I think it was Brian.
He was
it was
by,
two dudes.
It was one of my first podcast.
Brian and someone.
We'll go with Brian anyway.
Joe?
Tom? All
right, Tom. Stephen? I don't know.
Jack? We got to get this. Brian Christian.
Brian Christian.
Yes, wow. Brian Christian.
There is a co-author, isn't there? Is there a co-author?
Pretty sure there wasn't.
Really?
Okay. I'm not going to look that up.
Some reason, some books, the one author gets the credit. I like it. But
it's like Danny Kahneman. All these books, he gets the credit.
No one knows Amos.
And everyone else, nothing.
No one Amos gets nothing. But the explore exploit, like if you go to a new neighborhood,
yep.
And you try and find, all right, what's your best strategy to eat the best meals for the whole time you're in that neighborhood?
Mm-hmm.
One, you can go to one restaurant and go there every day. Or you can explore at the very start, go to 100 different restaurants in the area, find out the best, and then exploit the best ones that you want to go to.
Yep.
So I think, like, of the three ways Asho said you can read our book, the best thing our book is for new readers is mm-hmm. it's the full exploration mode at the start of your reading journey.
Yep.
You're going to get a taste of 115 of the best books that we've come across, of the 400 plus books that we've read. And from that taste, then you can go out there and exploit fully any ideas that sort of resonate. And also, you know, back on the context of where you are in life, the first time you go through it, there's going to be different parts that appeal to you. And the next time you come across it, it's going to be an entirely different part of the book, I think, that might be appealing to them.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And also that timing piece, like coming back to things potentially at a different point in your life, certain books will speak to you more than others. So like I read Animal Farm in high school and I was like, what is this book about horses and pigs and shit? Like I didn't get it then. But then when I read it again, like literally about a year ago, in light of everything that's going on in the world, I was like, man, this book's incredible. This is legendary.
Yeah.
And similarly with like philosophy. Certain books, if you try to read philosophy when you're like 15 or 20, like all you want to do is go out and get pissed and party and whatnot. But once you get to a point in your life where you have some dark days, maybe in your mid-20s or late 20s, and you're kind of looking for answers, then you pick up some philosophy, whether it's Plato or Aristotle or whoever, and you're like, this, I get this. Like, this is giving me light with which I can, you know, pave my road to something better than where I am right now. I mean, and I guess the question really is, I mean, have there been books that you've come across in your own sort of reading journey that you've changed your mind about based on a change in your own sort of life circumstances?
Oh, massively. I think books that are incredible at the start of the reading journey are like habits books like The Compound Effect. For me, it was like, I don't know, the fifth or sixth book I read, and it was an absolute mind blower.
Yeah.
That I'd never really heard of habits before. I kind of heard a little bit about it, but realized that by this compound effect, by making this small, tiny, one little change every single day, that it compounds over years and decades to be this massive change in your life. That was like mind-blowing. And then like maybe 5 years later, I read The Slight Edge, which is an extremely similar book, saying the same thing, like a small decision compounded over a long time can send you in a really bad direction or a really good direction. I was like, yeah, this is great stuff, but I kind of already knew that. So down the track, it didn't have the same kind of impact. And then I guess in the other way around as well, philosophy was probably one for me too, where at the start, I didn't get it. I thought it was very wanky. I thought it was for dudes with long gray beards sitting in caves pondering life. And I had no interest in that. But then now it's kind of like, damn, there's some deep shit in there.
Yeah. And speaking of philosophy, you guys had Ryan Holiday on the podcast recently. Yeah. I know you guys were chasing him for a good 3.5-4 years. That's right. So great episode. People should definitely check that one out. Jonesy, what are your thoughts on the whole timing of books question?
My brain just went to that. What was the question I asked Ryan Holiday, and it just went flat?
Jonesy had crafted this.
There was a perfect question.
It was something along the lines of, like, you know, it seems like, because like he's had a pretty crazy career, like in his early 20s.
You were giving him a massage. That's what you were doing.
I know. I was just going too hard.
You've done a lot of stuff. I think you're going to be like the greatest author of our time.
That was Asho doing one of his Thailand specials.
$10 massage. But Jonesy, I think you said, like, how have you, all these opportunities in life, like, it seems like you've like invented opportunities out of thin air. And he was, I think he was like answering an email. He was like typing around the background. He's like, yeah, that's what everyone does. And that was the end of the question.
Jeez, and there was a bit of massage in there. But yeah, I think that when is very important. It goes both ways. Like, some books are amazing at the start and then you're not so impressed later down the track.
Yeah.
Goes the other way. Like recently, or early on, I read The Innovator's Dilemma. I couldn't get through it. It was just like too hard to read.
Yep.
It was one of the most recent books I read, and I was like, Jesus, this is insane.
Mm-hmm.
It was phenomenal. It's such a good book. But at the start, I probably just didn't have my head around it. But I think when he put that book amongst like a whole bunch of other business books, and it sort of fits in somewhere, and sort of it's like a tree, I think. Like when your tree, you sort of build it up from the trunk upwards. You got your core books, but then you can sort of explore more deep and more narrow and niche topics. And I think as you read more and more books, those books sort of make sense. Which I think, like, The Innovator's Dilemma sort of does. It's like one context in business that is across a lot of businesses right now. And it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. Look, I love The Innovator's Dilemma. And I think he takes a concept that's quite arbitrary, like, you know, disruptive innovation, and actually boils it down to what is a pretty sort of measurable and predictable science.
And it's like irrefutable. Yeah. It's like grounded in reality, a lot of it. And so it's quite insane how he did that.
Yeah.
It's funny, his book's like, you're sure that all the top CEOs out there and whatnot, a lot of them probably haven't read it, but it's like one of those books that at the start of your reading journey, you just want to slap over people's heads. It's like that one, but for later in your reading journey.
Yeah, definitely. And the problem there is with a lot of the senior or the big executives at companies, I mean, they're playing finite games in a way where they're there for 4 years, they want to collect their paycheck, you know, deliver on one or two key performance indicators and move on to another company. That's right. And that's part of the problem. Whereas if they were playing an infinite game and they were there for the rest of their lives and the livelihood of their kids and grandkids was tied to how well they performed in this role, it would be a different story. Maybe that's a compensation package we can roll out at my company. you know, we've been talking a lot about nonfiction books, and I know that's your sort of wheelhouse, but what are your thoughts on fiction books, and have you read many fiction books and learned anything from them that you think applies to life? Because I know in my own experience, like reading, say, The Alchemist from Paulo Coelho taught me that oftentimes we go on these long, arduous journeys to effectively learn that, you know, the treasure we were searching for was pretty much at our feet the whole time. But you don't appreciate that, or you don't see that until you've kind of gone off into the jungle and into the desert and done stuff. So similarly, like...
Jesus, was that what the book was about? Sounds, even though I've read it, that was like...
It was like episode 6 or something, yeah.
Yeah. But I didn't have that. I could have completely missed the point, but maybe that was my...
But then there's books like Homer's Odyssey and the Iliad, well, the Odyssey in particular, about that journey home and whatnot. And sometimes you've got to go and fight man-eating cyclopses, get enslaved by a nymph, have your crew... some people might like that, but have your crew wrecked at sea and all that sort of stuff, or your ship wrecked. And you've got to like climb those mountains to get to the end goal, which was, you know, being reunited with his wife and son after 10 years, you know, on that sort of journey. Yeah, I guess the question is, what's one book, one fiction book that you've taken some life lessons out of? If there are any.
I don't know if there is any yet. I think I've had a crack at a few fiction ones, but nothing's really grabbed me yet.
Yep.
I used to read a lot of Dan Brown, but I wouldn't recommend that for big life lessons. Yeah. It's more just entertainment purposes. Yeah, I've had a crack. I've tried. Like, I read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. It didn't really grab me. I read Fahrenheit 451. I thought it was good. Nice little short book to ease my way in. I think that the core message, if I was writing a year 12 essay, I could probably polish something up, but I don't know if it would change my life at this point. But I think I'll keep searching. I think I'll keep, yeah.
Yeah, well, you guys are in a six-month lull now where you've got a big backlog of podcasts recorded, so you can...
I'll explore a few.
Explore. Well, explore and maybe exploit.
That's right, maybe.
I think you might be the same, Asho. I get my fiction from movies. I know that's a cheap way out, but that hero's journey you were saying, which can be inspirational where you learn a lot, it's very similar you get from movies. Like, I can't tell the difference if it's you get the entertainment plus the storytelling in a more concise way.
Yep.
You might lose a bit of the gist of what's going on, but yeah, movies is probably my fiction territory and non-fiction's my learning territory.
Yeah, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I mean, the greatest philosopher of all time would have to be Rocky Balboa.
Yeah.
And one thing that he said that always sticks with me is life's all about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. And
that's right. There you go.
I think it's so true. And I think a lot of us sometimes forget that and you kind of, I don't like the way this makes me feel. Oh, they said no. Oh, I'm going to go back to where I was before and get a comfortable job and not have to worry about selling stuff or whatever it is, you know. So to best sell this book, I mean, we've had a great conversation today, but what I want to do now, it's kind of a lightning round.
Ooh,
but
yeah.
The lightning round is in 30 seconds or less.
Goodness. Yeah.
You're going to tell me what you've learned about a specific topic and from which book. So one golden nugget.
Does it have to match a book? Because it was about 6 months ago we wrote it. I don't remember what was in there.
Do your best. If there's a book that comes to mind, let me know the book. But at least one golden nugget. So
are we alternating? What's the go?
Sorry?
Are we like alternating?
We're alternating. We're alternating. Okay. So Ashto first.
Okay.
Given that you're on the mic already. 30 seconds or less. Tell me what you learned about Korea.
Ooh, Korea. I think there's many ways to scale the mountain. You can take the well-worn path, you know, just take the steps up to the top.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to kind of forge your own path and go through the jungle a little bit, it might be harder. It might be more difficult. You might get bitten by a snake or eaten by a bear on the way up. But if you get to the top, it will have been a pretty good journey, I reckon.
Fantastic. I love that. That's Seth Godin, isn't it?
I think it's Nash original.
I think a mix of probably a
bit of both. So this is what we're talking about earlier. Like, it all feeds your subconscious. You throw all these ideas together. There's a bit of a stew and out comes that.
Actually, no, the best, probably the closest was Sheryl Sandberg. She talks about like that. It's not like a career ladder. It's like a career jungle gym. And I kind of turned that jungle gym into a mountain, I guess.
Yeah.
Subconsciously.
A bit more philosophical.
Yeah, that's right. She didn't have too many snakes or bears in her version.
Yeah, or massages.
That's right.
Jonesy, what have you learned in 30 seconds or less about marketing?
Ooh, so much. I'd go with the crossing the chasm. So there's three ways to actually... there's a few ways you can cross the chasm.
What is the chasm?
Ah, sorry, of course. There were only 30 seconds here.
We're 10 seconds in, mate. You've got to...
You're the innovators, early adopters. Early adopters, early majority, late majority and whatnot. So in order to penetrate that, we need to, use the analogy of World War II, focus all your resources in as small a beachhead as you possibly can. Take over the beachhead and from there you can actually take over Europe. Get rid of Hitler and then take care of the market.
Yeah, I think that's a great lesson. And sometimes people embarking on new ventures might get overwhelmed with how much there is to do. But find a small beachhead that you can dominate and then go from there and just start very small. And just even if you don't win that first battle, you'll learn something. But a lot of people are just scared to, you know, to jump out of their proverbial ships onto those beachheads to begin with. Like, ooh, I don't like the look of that beachhead.
And just to tack on an extra, I think I had 5 seconds left.
That's a long 30 seconds.
I think that applies for your personal career as well. And your having your own, you know, own beachhead in that sense is very helpful as well.
Yeah.
Marketing's can be a metaphor for everything.
All right, I think I'm going to
seconds up.
Cut a couple of these. But we'll go back to Ash though. 30 seconds or less? 30 seconds? Mastery.
Mastery. Well, mastery, there's a book in itself, Mastery by Robert Greene is a great book on mastery.
You got an easy one.
Yeah,
that's kind of point you in the right direction.
That's right. I'd say that picking what you want to master is vitally important before you actually start on that journey to mastery. I think like there is like a relatively clear way to learn new skills, but I think probably the most important before actually learning it is like picking what do you actually want to commit to, because it's going to take a bloody long time.
Yeah.
And you don't want to get 60% of the way through mastering something and realize that actually maybe I want to master something else.
Yeah, and perhaps that's where the whole emotion plus rationality comes back into it, because oftentimes you might pick something based on emotion because everybody else is learning about blockchain and therefore I need to learn about it too. But rationally, is it really something that's going to benefit your career? Is it in line with your objectives? Are there other things that you're perhaps better incentivized to learn about that's going to help you in your current role or help you get to what you want to get to in your life? And sometimes I think we make certain big decisions like that very quickly and not realizing that, hey, this might actually take up the next 2 or 3 years of our lives when we could have done something else, and just completely discounting the opportunity cost. But that was good. That was about 37.2 seconds. Nice. So we'll throw it back over to Jonesy. Money.
Ooh. Money. I'd say there's a couple of things that go in. So number one, there's
Isn't
two ways.
Only one thing? We're only doing one thing, aren't
we? Yeah, we were just doing one thing. One golden nugget.
Actually, you surely eating my time. Okay, so there's I think there's two parts of money. There's number one, it's controlling how much things you want, and that's stepping off the hedonic treadmill and keeping up with the Joneses. Mm-hmm. So that's one way.
You are a Jones, so it's a bit hard not to.
Yeah.
Like, you're kind of baked in. It doesn't matter what you do, you're still keeping up.
So that's one way to become financially free, and then mix that in with really, you know, controlling expenses, I'm not as big a fan of, because there's a limit to how much you control expenses.
Yeah. Stop buying coffees. I've heard that advice.
It's a bit bloody boring, terrible. That one. But there's no limit to how much you can earn. So focusing on your earning potential, growing a scarce skill set, and increasing your value to the marketplace. And then add those two things together and, money will be on its way, hopefully.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And sometimes you can do everything right and still not get the desired result. And I think that's something we have to concede as a bug rather than a feature of life. And we'll go with two more. Let's go back to Ashto, behavior, human behavior.
I think the one thing I've learned is that everybody's pretty cooked and everybody does things that don't really make a lot of sense. If you actually weighed up the costs and the benefits, you'd realize you're probably doing a lot of things wrong, like in the rational sense of it. And again, I think it's a feature and a bug. It can work both ways. But I think if you can kind of get a better understanding of yourself and your own sort of pulls and what things that you kind of do that you wish you didn't do, I think if you can at least moderate your own behavior to do more of what you want and less of what you don't want, I think that you're heading in the right direction. Yeah.
Fantastic. Very succinct. And lucky last, I mean, Ashto's already given us his take on love. Jonesy.
Love. We'll go with... In terms of cultivating love, you've got that first in love experience where everyone's trying to game each other and you're kind of hiding your blemishes. But I think after that, that's where the real love begins. So be prepared for that part where you're past that euphoria stage and something you got to really work on. And I think the best framework to working on love and relationships is, I'd say, the five love languages, which is what we cover in the book. Mm-hmm. And it's learning what your own love language is and sort of optimizing for that in your relationship, but also for your partner. And if you do that and you've got this mindset that you're a team together, strolling through life, then love can be an awesome thing to inject into your own life.
Yeah, definitely. And I think sometimes it's also about acknowledging that you are two different people with your own journeys, but you're going to walk a road side by side. As opposed to morph into one entity, which I think sometimes you see that on Facebook profiles. It's like Jack and Jill Jones. It's like, ooh.
Too close.
And Esther Perel talks about that too. She's like, once you become too close and the mystery is gone, the intimacy dies. So you need to maintain some semblance of separation in your own unique identity and mystery and distance. Otherwise... Yeah, and we saw that play out with a lot of relationships during lockdown where people were more or less locked up together for extended periods of time, and a lot of relationships didn't make it through that. So anyway, that's my two cents on love. we're going to bring this one to a close, boys. This has been a fascinating conversation about all things self-development, shall we say. People can pick up the book at whatyouwilllearn.com, as well as all good places books are sold. Amazon, Dimex, where else?
Yeah.
Barnes & Noble.
Book Depository.
Yeah. Wherever you buy books. Book Depository, Booktopia. Yeah.
There's a few that add an extra markup now necessary. I think the most cost-effective and speediest way for people to buy it is probably Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
Just go straight to there, and I'd say that's the best place to buy it.
Yep, and that's the shit they never taught you. And if people want to follow you on the Twitterverse, on Instagram, on Facebook, did they just search for What You Will Learn?
What You Will Learn, yeah. I guess that's like we follow the journey where our profile has merged to become one, which is contrary to your love advice, but we've just got the one profile, What You Will Learn.
Yep, fantastic. Well, boys, this has been an absolute treat. I think it's time we went off and got a massage.
Let's do it.
Let's end it there. Well, I've just returned from my neck and shoulders massage. I'm feeling nice and limbered up, feeling nice and loose, but the other two blokes are nowhere to be seen. I don't know. Maybe they're still in there. Maybe they were getting a different, more lengthy massage than my one. But anyway, when Steve-O came on our podcast 12 months ago to launch his book, Time Rich, he had a nice song for us, personalized about us and our podcast and Jonesy and I. And Jonesy, as sometimes he likes to do, is talk without thinking. And he committed us to saying to Steve-O, next time we're on Steve-O's show, that we would write him a song. Anyway, in the 12 months that ensued, we couldn't quite find time to write that song. But I thought, you know what? I'll take it upon myself to have a crack, and we'll see how we go. Well, one time I went out to the bookstore. I was looking for some knowledge, and I saw a couple of books, bright and yellow, and I wonder who is this fellow. One is called Time Rich, the other employee to entrepreneur. I get excited, I pick him up, I wonder what you will learn. Who is this author? What is he gonna do to me? Wow, what a legend, Steve Glaveski. Glaveski. Steve Glaveski. To the train, want more knowledge in my brain, and look for a podcast. Should I listen to Steve Blank, Gad Sad, or Adam Grant, or could I choose one? Stumble on some gold, it's called Future Squared, I am told. All these legends in one place, who could host it, what is his name? I glance at my phone, look back at the books, could it be? Wow, yes it is, it's Steve Glaveski. Glaveski, what a legendary legend, Steve Glaveski.
Hi guys, Steve again. I hope you enjoyed this episode. If you'd like to receive a weekly email from me, complete with reflections, books I've been reading, words of wisdom, and access to blogs, ebooks, and more that I'm publishing on a regular basis, just leave your details at futuresquared.xyz/subscribe and you'll receive the very next one. If you're picking up what I'm putting down, take a minute to like, share, or subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. It goes a long way to giving the podcast the exposure it needs so I can continue bringing you guests and conversations of the highest caliber. You can catch me on Twitter at Steve Glaveski and on Instagram at TheSteveGlaveski. Until next time...
Hasta la vista, baby.
This has been an No Filter Media production.
Say what you want.